Good evening, everyone. It's my great delight all for today's book launch event, Mind Your Mind. With a big round of applause, I would like to introduce today's speaker. Sriman Venugopal Acharya ji, also known as Sri Vraj Bihari Das. He is a full-time monk, counselor, self-help author, lifestyle coach, and teacher at Sri Sri Radha Gopinath Mandir ISKCON Chowpatty since the last 2 decades. He has a major's degree in economics and a master's in monetary policy and international finance. He joined the Times Group after completing his MBA in finance and has a wealth of corporate experience, having undertaken projects for multinational companies such as KPMG and ICICI Bank. As a member of the education and training body for congregation development at ISKCON, Vraj Bihari Prabhu counsels young men in the monastery and trains a satellite community of more than 150 families in Borivali and Kandivali area. He shares his daily reflections, meditations, and discourses on his website, www.yogaformodernage.com. With over 950 plus articles on his website and over hundreds of talks on his YouTube channel, Mr. Acharya continues to help and guide the masses across borders through his social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and LinkedIn presence. You can find him at the rate vacharya108. His recent release, Mind Your Mind, Three Principles for Happy Living, which is the book we are launching today, is the result of his daily study, writing, contemplation, and prayers over the last 20 years. In his writings, he shares different tools to help one feel loved and improve relationships with oneself and with those who matter to us. One of his works, a fiction called Cricket in a Monastery, reveals valuable life lessons from a game of cricket. He is a seasoned international speaker, having traveled and spoken in the USA, Australia, UK, Germany, Russia, and other parts of Europe and Middle East. In his talks, he shares candid thoughts on mental hygiene, spiritual discipline, and finding deep emotional fulfillment. His lucid and cheerful talks connect to the audience from all walks of life. His main strength being the ability to harmonize wisdom from Vedic era to enhance our modern lives. He often says, the principles of life are simple and same everywhere. Just apply even a little and see a big difference. So we will start the book launch. To start the book launch, I would like to invite our esteemed guests, Sri Rohini Nandan ji, Devi Priya Mata ji, Shrivan Rasparayan ji, and Vraj Sundar ji. Please come on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, please have a big round of applause as we launch the book, Mind Your Mind.
Thank you very much for coming and giving me an opportunity to share something that is very close to my heart. I'll be very authentic and honest with you as I'm going to speak about this book, because this has taken me 21 years of observation, prayers and life in the monastery, and last 9 years of active research and thought process into the book. So I'm going to speak on 3 things today. First, I'm going to explain to you briefly what exactly are these 3 principles that I've spoken in the book about mind management. I'll just introduce those 3 concepts or those 3 principles called awareness, acceptance and aspiration. These 3 are magic principles that can help you live peacefully with yourself. So I'm going to give a brief introduction to these 3 principles first. Then once you have done that, then the second topic which I want to really focus upon is how to apply this principle in our day-to-day life. So I'll just give you 2 examples or 3. In this book, I have given 1 practical case study in the end of how to apply these principles. I've given steps. And you can have your own daily examples. It requires little practice, but you can also master this. So that is the second topic which I'm going to present. And third, if we have some time left, I would like to read about some sections from the book where I've spoken about techniques by which you could develop these 3 principles. Like I'll read 1 chapter for each of the 3 principles. So there are how many? 38 chapters in this book. Basically 38 keys or 38 techniques. Different techniques are there. So we have 13, 14, 27, 38 chapters. And I would like to read 3 chapters. 1 for awareness, 1 for acceptance and 1 for aspiration. So these are the 3 topics. Is that okay? So first, what exactly are these 3 principles of mind management that this book is talking about? How many of you have taken painkillers in life at some point of time? Kabhi to liya hoga na? Like I'll tell you, I take painkillers only so far in my life, only when I have toothache, massive toothache. Toothache, somehow it's I think one of the worst pains, right? So painkiller is a must, many times. But imagine if you take only painkillers every day, what will happen to your body? Kidney fail, body will really suffer. So painkillers have a value, but they cannot be used always. So what we really need is medicine. Medicines are much better than painkillers. And generally medicines are different, painkillers are different, right? Right? Generally it is like that. Some healthy medicines you take every day, they may not necessarily be painkillers, but in the long run they remove the disease, they remove the pain. But for the mind, I have discovered in my journey that these 3 principles that I'm going to talk about, they are excellent painkillers also, excellent medicine also, and excellent everyday food and nourishment also. Generally your food is different, painkiller is different, medicines are different. But these 3 principles can be food, nourishment for the body, mind also. So I'm going to speak about this. Like, you know, in Ayurveda, they have haldi, turmeric. When you get a wound, you put turmeric. Have you done that? Anybody ever? So the turmeric is antiseptic. It also removes the pain and it also helps in the long run, medicinally. Like last week, I was at my nephew's wedding. The young boy, excited, was getting married, and we were all pulling his leg and making fun of him. So I have, because of certain protocols I follow in the monastery, monk order, we don't go for marriages. But we can go before and after the marriage for the function. So they had this haldi function. So I was there. It was a very festive mood, sab naach gana chal raha tha. And they were happy to see me. And I was seeing my nephew, my other, many of my relatives after a long time, actually, 15, 20 years. So this joking was going on. And I saw everybody's hands was with the haldi, you know. So it was all fun. So they said, aap kuch boliye. So I looked at the to-be bride and others and I joked. I said, well, shadi ek aisa zakhm hai,
जिसमें चोट लगने के पहले हल्दी लगाई जाती है. So we all laugh. So yeah, but I was talking about haldi, I remembered that. So that's about basically we need something in our lives by which we feel shelter, whether it is painful situation, whether it is happy situation. And these three A's, awareness, acceptance and aspiration, what are they? So I'll briefly explain that through the introduction of the book. So generally a preface of a book is where the author writes why he wrote the book or the how the book has been written, which I won't get into because it's another story in itself. But introduction gives the summary of the book, the essence of the book. So I'll briefly read from the introduction. It's actually long, it's 8 pages, but I'll just read 2-3 pages. Okay, then you'll get an idea of what these three principles are. "Excuse me," I yelled. I was in a state of panic and my words came out with difficulty. "Do man-eating tigers roam around here?" A little distance away, I had just spotted a man who seemed to be about 70 years old. He turned towards me, a dreamy look on his face. How could he remain unruffled while wandering alone in this lonely and dangerous forest? I wondered. He murmured as he lazily picked up twigs from the forest floor. I could not understand his behavior. Dissonant sounds rang through the forest. I recognized cuckoos, crickets, squirrels, monkeys, and maybe a woodpecker's song, but most of the sounds in the forest were foreign to me. The forest itself appeared strange and foreboding. A sudden gust of wind had the trees swinging erratically. Giant fig trees and verdant bushes sent a chill through my spine because I thought perhaps a lion was prowling behind them. "You are sweating," the man observed nonchalantly. The pre-dawn hours of the winter were biting cold, and yet I was perspiring profusely. I fumbled. "I heard there are tigers and lions here. It's true. Is this true?" "I am not deaf," he said. "Oh, sorry." I hadn't realized that my voice had risen again in fear. This is a true story. This happened with me. I'm sharing in this book, in the introduction of this book. I used to walk every day for 2 hours before sunrise at the Sanjay Gandhi National Park in Borivali on the outskirts of northern Mumbai. Today was no different until I suddenly remembered a friend's casual remark a few days ago. When I told him I was going for these walks, he mentioned that there were leopards and tigers in the forest. He was amused to hear that I walked alone every morning. He even suggested in passing that I carry a stick with me, or better still, wait for sunrise before I ventured into the jungle. However, we had spoken of many things that evening and had forgotten about this discussion until this morning. Is everybody with me so far? At a particularly dark ridge on the eastern side of the woods, I had just spotted a flock of deer scamper. The branches of the tree shook violently and birds frantically flapped their wings. In an instant, the stillness was broken. I was gripped by a sudden terror, and snippets of that conversation with my friend came rushing back to me. I wondered desperately if there was a dangerous animal about. I was all alone and absolutely no way to protect myself. Ironically, the previous evening I had presented a seminar called Overcoming Fear, at which I had delineated systematic 8 steps to tame the wild mind. 8 hours later, I stood here exposed. I didn't remember a word of my talk. I didn't even know who I was or where I was. All I wanted to do was turn around and run. My flight response was fully activated. Here I was, a preacher and a monk, well known to members of the community to which I delivered discourses on the mind, soul and God. But at this moment, All I could think of was how I was going to become some tiger's meal, breakfast. I looked at a giant tree nearby and wondered if I could climb it for safety. But what if there was a snake coiled in its branches? Years ago, I read in the papers that a lion had escaped from the park and attacked a few people before he was caught. I had not thought about that incident all these years. Now I was convinced that that lion, apart from the tiger and snake, was also lurking nearby. It was at this point that I met this old man. Oddly enough, he seemed to be at home here, even as I felt the sword of death dangling above my head. After hearing my terrified questions, he looked at my saffron robes and his eyes widened. "Oh, you are a Swami," he said. "Yes, there are tigers and leopards here." Then with a dismissive wave of his hand, he said, "You don't worry though. After all, you are a Swami. The tigers won't do anything to you." I gulped. How will a tiger know the difference between a monk and someone else? And why will he forsake a good breakfast? Do tigers respect holy men? I tried being sarcastic, but my fear was palpable. "Oh, son," the old man said, "you clearly don't know the rules of the jungle. The animals see saffron or red and immediately think it is fire. They stay away. That's why the holy men who once lived in the forest wore red cloth or saffron cloth. But if you're in the ocean, avoid red. The sharks will mistake it for blood and attack you immediately, even if they are hundreds of miles away." I felt reassured that the tigers wouldn't get me. After all, the wise old man knew better than me the ways of the forest. And he was confident I was safe. Still, I decided not to take any chances and I hastily began my journey out of the forest. Mercifully, the sun rose bright and eventually the sight of other morning walkers with their long sticks gave. What's happening? Hare Krishna. This voice is going and coming. Just. Anyway, so now I told this incident, this is the introduction. The incident happened with me in that forest. So what happened, this incident changed the way I thought about my thoughts. I'll repeat. We think, all of us think, but do we think about our thinking? That is my point. So after I returned from the forest, I sat alone feeling dazed, trying to comprehend what happened. Now, I realized that I know very little about my mind. I may speak about it in lectures, but there is a huge gap between the theory I preached from the scriptures and what I had actually internalized. So I realized that so far, now please, ladies and gentlemen, listen to this statement very carefully. On this particular day, I realized that all these years I had been seeing the world through my mind. That day, thanks to the experience in the forest, I took a step back within my internal world and actually observed how my mind functioned. Instead of seeing through the mind, I now saw the mind. Is this clear? This is the foundation of this seminar. Till now, I analyzed others with the help of my mind. But now suddenly I had some awareness of my own mind. The old man had shown me a mirror to my emotional state. How many of you feel different emotions like love, angry, fear, right? Now, when you are aware of your feelings, rather than simply feeling them, when you are aware of your feelings rather than simply feeling them, you have taken a step back within yourself and you have become an observer to your feelings and your thoughts. For example, if you feel fearful on a dark night, if you recognize at that moment that your mind is feeling fear, you are actually beginning the process of separating yourself from that emotion and you have risen above the mind. At least you have begun the process. This is the first step and this is called as awareness. Is this clear? Now, my experience in the forest actually changed me at a deeper level. Because in the past, you know, I would tell my friends many times, I'm very ordinary, you know. Like we say that out of humility, we say, you know, I'm ordinary. And I used to think I'm very modest and gracious. When somebody would praise me, I would say, no, it's Lord's grace. Now, this morning in the forest, however, I had a rude wake-up call. I knew I was ordinary. Do you get it? Like to say I'm ordinary is one thing, to actually realize I'm ordinary, I have my fears, I'm vulnerable, I'm nervous. But now this awareness was there. Now the most difficult to the second step, was I ready to accept that I'm an average person filled with insecurities and fears? It took me a few weeks of prayer, introspection, to come to terms with who really I am. But when I accepted my failures, accepted who I am, I made peace with myself. I felt like a free bird. Azad panchi. Nikal laya hoon. This shayari is not in the book. I spontaneously remember. Nikal laya hoon pinjre se ek parinda. Nikal laya hoon pinjre se ek parinda. Ab us parinde ke dil se pinjra nikalna baki hai. So this cage, you have released the bird from the cage, but there is a cage inside the bird's heart. So when I made peace with myself, I felt like a free bird. In fact, in one of my classes, I caused a mild shock when I said to the audience that I was a monk by accident. So they were like, what? I said, yeah, I don't know how I said, you know, I know some married couples who tell me after 30, 40 years of marriage, pata nahi kaise ho gaya, hamara love marriage tha, pata nahi kaise shaadi ho gaya. 40 saal se jhel rahe ek dusre ko. Theek hai, abhi hum log sahan kar rahe. And they happily laugh about it. So I said, mera bhi aise hua, 20 saal pehle pata nahi kaise ho gaya. So when I said that, and then I also said how I had the same aspirations and need for emotional support, like, they had, the audience had. But nonetheless, I have made a choice of being single and I am happily paying the price and enjoying the rewards of this choice. Right? Mere akelepan ka mazak banane walon, zara ye to batao, ki jis bheed mein tum khade ho, usme kaun tumhara hai? Right?
So, but when I came to terms with this, it was a big relief. I accepted who I am. I didn't see myself as somebody who's wearing this cloth, you know. I respect this cloth. I respect the position. And I want to live by integrity. At the same time, I am not what I wear. Cloth is my choice. I am beyond the cloth. And when I accepted myself with all my frailties, I felt free. That is called acceptance. Is it clear? Awareness is clear. Acceptance is clear. For awareness, I told the story of the forest. Acceptance is, see, I realized awareness is actually of who I am. It is a gift we get from the Lord. Especially when we live by sattva. Sattva is a energy of goodness. There is a 15-page chapter in this book on three energies that control us invisibly. And it's written with a lot of stories, examples and analogies. Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. How these ropes bind us all the time and how we can, we are always controlled, but we have a choice of which of these ropes to allow to control us. So that I've discussed. So I'll not get into that now. But when we live by Sattva, when we live a clean life, pure life, we are gifted with awareness. Suddenly you become aware. Very often you become aware of what's happening to you. Now, I'll be elaborating this. If you read the book, chapter 2 especially, we'll explain in great detail. So, awareness is what? It's a gift you get. But, please remember this.
Acceptance is a choice. It is your willingness to accept being small in this giant cosmos, to feel humble, insignificant, and yet feel loved by the Lord. Now, I had awareness and I had acceptance. But do you know something? It is a challenge to sustain this feeling of awareness and acceptance because mind is much, much more craftier than you can imagine. Therefore, we need third principle. See, I may choose to be humble, but the mind will again trick me. See, it didn't take me long to realize, to forget that I am small, I am insignificant. I again became proud. I thought I am better than many others because I know so much philosophy, spirituality. I would speak about pride and humility in my lectures, but I did not realize that I still was full of myself. Like my Guru Maharaj, Radhanath Swami Maharaj, he often says that the proud man may behave humbly, but he will be proud of it. I'm so humble. I'm the most humble man in this universe. Of all the good qualities I have, humility is my best quality. So it is very tricky. Mind is very tricky. So what is the way out? We need to connect to a noble aspiration, a purpose beyond my mind, a purpose to serve, a purpose to give, a purpose to contribute. And when we have a higher purpose, then we can tolerate the mind going here and there because we'll be focused. The purpose wrong rehta hai, mind doesn't matter. Like I speak the story of Hirkani Bai from Raigad. She was living in the Pachha village called Pachhad. And she had to climb the fort every day and she would sell her milk and other wares in the fort. This is 1675 when Emperor Shivaji was controlling Maharashtra, Deccan. So that time, Hirkani Bai had to come back to the gate by sunset, otherwise the gates would close. But one day she came a little late and the gates closed. And the guard said, now you have to be inside till morning. She said, no, but my baby is crying in the house, I have to go. He said, no. So then she said, no, I have to go. So she looked everywhere, 70 foot high walls, no way she could escape. So she was wondering what to do. And she had heard from one of her friends that on the eastern side, the guards had not made a wall because the wall was so steep, the fort was so steep that no army chief or general would also dare to scale the fort or go down. But that was the only chance she had. It's 3,000 feet above sea level. She went there. She climbed down, warding off the bats, the snakes that were slithering by, the owls and jackals that were shrieking. She came down to the forest. She reached her home. She fed her baby. And next day morning, she was back at the fort to sell her milk. And the night shift guard, he hadn't left. And he saw her. He was shocked. An alarm was raised. Then how did she breach the security system? She was produced in front of Shivaji and Shivaji said, how did you do it? And then she explained, he couldn't believe it. He said, great army chiefs cannot do it. How can you do it? Take me to the spot. Can you do it again? Yes, of course I can do it again, she said. So he brought her there. He said, okay, do it now. So she climbed the steps very confidently. She stood on the edge of that eastern side cliff top spot. And then she looked down and guess what happened? She froze in horror. No, Majesty, my dear Majesty, you can't do it. And Shivaji smiled because he knew that she was speaking the truth because her hands were bruised, her clothes were kind of shabby. He knew that she was speaking the truth about the previous night's escape. He honored her and he named that spot as Hirkani Burj, a bastion of Hirkani. Now, how could a simple woman do what great army chiefs could not? How could she transcend the fear of the mind? She had a passion, an aspiration to live for a purpose. And what is that purpose? Her baby. You know, some terrorists, they may have a purpose, a negative purpose, and they transcend all fear. So if a negative motivation can help you transcend the mind, how much more a positive energy of love, sacrifice, dedication can help? So these are the three. So basically, I'll summarize the essence of these three principles. So is it clear? So now I'll go to the second topic. The first topic was I wanted to give an introduction to what is awareness, acceptance, and aspiration. So awareness means what in simple words? Okay, I'll just read this one line just for you to. Awareness is the cognizance. Cognizance means to know. Awareness is a cognizance of what's happening now. Like anytime you ask yourself, what's happening now? What is my mind feeling now? What does my mind need now? That is awareness. Is this clear? And acceptance is letting go the resistance. Not fighting. Staying in the present moment without fear, without guilt, accepting. Okay. And aspiration means to seek a larger goal in life. Something deeper than achieving our daily to-do list. So these are the three principles that I've spoken in great detail in this book. Is this clear to everyone? This is the first topic I wanted to present. Awareness means to know what's happening now, and acceptance means what? Don't resist. Don't resist what you are aware of. The more you resist and more you fight it, like if you're in depression. Yes, I am depressed or I am sad, I am lonely. Accepting it is the first step for recovery. So awareness and acceptance, and then very important is aspiration. Aspiration means something more than my daily eating, sleeping, mating, defending. Now this sounds very attractive, but you may have a question, how to apply this? That is the second topic for today. How to apply these three principles in our day-to-day life? You want to know that? Okay. Now I will tell you how I apply these principles. You know, when I meet marriage counselors, or because you know I have some young couples who come to me, or young boys and girls, and they have their issues, and I'm not married, I've been single, so I don't know how to help them. So I connect them to the right people. So that's how I'm good friends with some senior marriage counselors also. So when I was talking to a senior marriage counselor, and I said, what is the secret of continuing your relationship for last so many years? So he said an interesting point. He said, we have a rule. Sometimes I am the first person to understand, and once she is satisfied that she has been understood by me, then I seek to be understood. First seek to understand, then seek to be understood. Now this is a principle that works with the mind also. पहले समझो क्या हो रहा है, फिर माइंड को समझाओ. हमारा प्रॉब्लम क्या है? फ्रॉम चाइल्डहुड वी स्टार्ट बैशिंग द माइंड. वी हैव बीन अनफॉर्चुनेटली ट्रेन्ड टू स्कोल्ड एंड क्रिटिसाइज आवर माइंड फ्रॉम चाइल्डहुड. सो द माइंड हैज रिकॉइल्ड लाइक अ वेरी नॉन कोऑपरेटिव स्पाउस हु हैज बीन अब्यूज्ड. यू कांट एस्केप द माइंड. इफ योर स्पाउस इज अब्यूजिंग यू कैन गो टू अ पुलिस स्टेशन एंड कंप्लेन. But where will you go? Which police station will register your complaint when you say mera mind mujhe abuse kar raha? And you can't escape your mind. Imagine you have somebody next to you who is always with you 24 hours. And that person doesn't leave you only. When you are eating food, he is sitting in front of you. When you are sleeping, that person is next to you. And even when you are in the toilet doing your business, that person is next to you. He or she is never separate from you. Don't you think it's worthwhile to make him a friend? अभी उसको छुटकारा तो पा नहीं सकते, अभी झगड़ा करेंगे तो हमारा लाइफ मिजरेबल होगा. इसलिए दैट्स अ कृष्णा इन द गीता 6th चैप्टर ही सेज बंधुरात्मात्मनस्तस्य एनात्मैवात्मना जितः अनात्मनस्तु शत्रुत्वे वर्तेतात्मैव शत्रुवत्. बंधु द माइंड कैन बी मेड अ बंधु फ्रेंड इफ वी आर एबल टू कीप आवरसेल्व्स अबव द माइंड एंड इफ वी कांट दैट बंधु बिकम्स अ रिपू एनिमी. अनात्मनस्तु शत्रुत्वे शत्रु बन जाता है. So therefore we need to understand that mind ke sath bhi thoda wahi principle follow karna. But many married people I know, they don't have time to understand each other. They only want to be understood. That's why they have problems. Someone grihastha told me, kya kare prabhu ji, koi nahi milta is duniya mein samajhne wala, jo bhi milta hai samjha ke chala jata hai. That is unfortunately life, you know. So like that, so why I'm saying this is because this is the foundation of practical application of these three principles. Awareness, so I follow 4 steps. Now these 4 steps are kind of integrated into my system. When I'm separating them as 4 steps, don't think that, okay, I have to do this, then no, it, by after practice, they all merge. So how do we do this? First step is, you know, like there are out of this, I'm going to share with you 4 steps of applying these principles. First 2 steps are understanding the mind, and the next 2 steps are instructing the mind and taking the mind along. So first step is awareness in the now. Like when the mind is, when you're an uncomfortable feeling, just like let's say your spouse is shouting or doing something, एक क्या चल रहा है, आप बैठ के सुनो. आप सुनोगे तो आपने क्या किया, अवेयरनेस बढ़ा दी आपके रिलेशनशिप का. सिमिलरली when your mind is disturbed, pause and ask, what's happening now? And second, very very important step, accept without judgment. Don't judge, accept. ठीक है, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं. वंस यू हैव डन दीज 2 स्टेप्स, इट्स लाइक यू आर टेलिंग द माइंड, सुना और उसको एक्सेप्ट किया. सो द माइंड इज नाउ पीसफुल. व्हेन यू आर हर्ड, व्हेन यू आर सैटिस्फाइड दैट यू बीन अंडरस्टूड, वुडंट यू वांट टू लिसन टू द अदर पर्सन. सिमिलरली व्हेन द माइंड इज सैटिस्फाइड दैट द माइंड इज बीन हर्ड, विच इज द फर्स्ट स्टेप अवेयरनेस, एंड सेकेंड एक्सेप्टेड, दीज 2 स्टेप्स आर डन. So the third step is negotiate with reason. Means connect to your aspiration. आपका कुछ तो aspiration है life में. Present that to the mind and you will see the mind cooperates. And fourth, very critical, deal with kindness gently. ज्यादा mind के ऊपर वो मत डालो, force मत डालो. So I'll give an example. I'll give this week only. There are at least three, four instances when I instinctively practice this. Like I'll give an example. Yesterday I was traveling, 4:30 in the morning I came to the railway station, my train reached Mumbai CST. I took a cab and the cab driver, and there were 4 cabs, nobody around. He said, Baba ji, aao hamare taxi mein. I said, meter ke saath se chalunga. He said, jo bhi hai aapko to extra dena padega, aap Baba ji hai. आई फिर, अरे हम बाबा जी इसलिए कम देंगे. अरे नहीं नहीं, बाबा जी लोगों के पास बहुत पैसा होता है. आई फिर, नहीं मेरे पास तो नहीं है. एंड देन द अदर 4 ऑफ देम स्टार्टेड लाफिंग. आई न्यू दैट दे आर, आई फेल्ट एंग्री बिकॉज आई कनेक्टेड, आई आइडेंटिफाइड विद द बाबा जी. आई डोंट नो व्हाई आई फेल्ट, मुझे इंसल्ट किया. तो आई क्वाइटली, आई हैड अ बैग, आई क्वाइटली वॉक्ड अहेड एंड दे सेड, नो बाबा जी, रुको महाराज, रुको, हमारे टैक्सी में हमारे टैक्स, हम ना गए. आई जस्ट इग्नोर देम. I turned back, मैं बस में जाऊंगा. They said, अरे बस नहीं है अभी 2 घंटे के लिए. Thank you. I walked ahead and there was one taxi fellow, he was sleeping. I woke him up and we came. And in the taxi when I sat, early morning, I was angry, irritated, you know. I felt insulted. But then immediately, because of the practice I do, I paused. Inhale to the count of 4, Hold your breath to the count of 8 and exhale to the count of 8. 4, 8, 8. बस दो मिनट भी नहीं किया. ओके व्हाट इज द प्रॉब्लम. सो इमीडिएटली आई वॉज कनेक्टिंग टू माई सेल्फ. सो व्हाट एम आई फीलिंग नाउ. आई एम फीलिंग एंग्री, रेस्टलेस, इरिटेटेड बिकॉज ऑफ व्हाट. बिकॉज आई नीड रेस्पेक्ट. दैट वॉज ऑब्वियस. बट व्हेन आई वाज अवेयर इट वॉज लाइक टेलिंग दम. इट इज लाइक नोइंग व्हाट्स हैपनिंग. इट्स अ बिग रिलीफ टू नो. Rather than feeling angry and irritated whole day, at least I know that I am angry because I need respect. Have you ever experienced this? Somebody, you know, when I was a kid, I used to be very afraid of my father, but never my mother. Because my mother used to be angry, she used to shout, and we used to know predictable behavior. But my father, you know, he was very quiet when he was angry. When he was more angry, he would talk softly. You know, I'm very angry with you right now. When somebody says he is very angry with a half smile, that's so scary because you know that this person is in control of himself. Right? So, to know, to be angry is one thing, but to be aware of your anger is another thing. Completely, it's a different ball game. So, in the taxi yesterday morning, it's a 20-minute drive from CST to our temple. And I was like, I am angry because I need respect. Awareness. Then immediately second was to accept without judgment. It's okay to be angry. It's okay to have a need for respect. It's okay. You are after all human. So that's a big relief because in scriptural study we constantly hear how we should be servant of servant. We should never aspire for any respect. That's also true. But when you are disturbed and troubled, at that time what the mind needs is, at that time the mind doesn't need lecture on how you should be humble. उस समय माइंड को हक करने का. ठीक सी यू नो देयर आर टू थिंग्स हियर. वी ऑल हैव रिलेशनशिप विद अदर्स एंड वी ऑल्सो हैव रिलेशनशिप विद आवरसेल्फ. इफ यू वांट टू हैव अ हैप्पी रिलेशनशिप विद योरसेल्फ यू नीड टू हैव सेल्फ एक्सेप्टेंस. एंड इफ यू वांट टू हैव अ गुड रिलेशनशिप विद अदर्स यू नीड सेल्फ क्रिटिसिज्म. सेल्फ क्रिटिसिज्म इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इफ यू वांट टू हैव गुड रिलेशनशिप विद अदर्स. बट इफ यू वांट टू हैव अ गुड रिलेशनशिप विद योरसेल्फ, सेल्फ एक्सेप्टेंस बहुत जरूरी है. सो आई फॉलोड दीज टू स्टेप्स. सो यू नो व्हाट हैज हैपेंड व्हेन आई फॉलोड दीज टू स्टेप्स. माइंड इज ठंडा बिकॉज माइंड को एक्सेप्टेंस मिला. जनरली व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन वी इफ आई वाज नॉट ट्रेन्ड इन दिस, यू नो व्हाट वुड हैव हैपेंड. आई वुड हैव गॉट एंग्री. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल इन द टैक्सी आई वुड नॉट नो व्हाट इज हैपनिंग. मे बी आई वुड हैव फॉक्ड विद दैट टैक्सी फेलो ऑल्सो, व्हाई यू आर चार्जिंग मोर. Or what? I would have come back to temple and I would have fought with somebody else. But because of awareness and most importantly acceptance, my mind became peaceful. Suna na mind ko. Now the mind was ready for the third step: negotiate with reason. Very briefly, I said, my dear Chanchal. So I've called my mind as Chanchal. That's the name I use in my journals. You can also have your own name for the mind. It's very important for us to separate ourselves from the mind for some time of the day at least. Generally, our identity is merged with the mind all the time, right? Kuch samay ke liye ab mind ko aisa dekho, alag se. Just like you are not the body, you say, no, my body is paining. Like I say, this is my watch. That means the watch is different from me. I say, this is my body. That means I am different from the body. Similarly, this is my mind. Means I am separate from the mind. So the third step was, I briefly opened my, I have a chanting prayer bead, which I will talk about in the end. So I took my bead bag. I just put my hand in the beads. I said, my dear mind, life is short. And we have a goal to achieve. We want to love God. And these kind of issues will happen every day, 100 times in a day. Forget it. Choti si baat hai, bhul jao. And the mind could accept it. But the fourth step was very important. That is, a lecture jyada namma nahi dene ka mind. Because mind cooperates. See, mind is a simple phenomenon. माइंड का एक ही दो ही फंक्शन है, एक्सेप्ट रिजेक्ट, लाइक डिसलाइक. इंटेलिजेंस इज नेस्टी एक्चुअली, अनदर सब्जेक्ट मैटर, आई डोंट गेट इट राइट नाउ. बट द फर्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ माई बुक आफ्टर इंट्रोडक्शन इज ऑल अबाउट माइंड, इंटेलिजेंस एंड ईगो, हाउ दिस थ्री आर डिफरेंट. With simple examples I have mentioned, you will understand it very clearly. But at this particular point in the car, in the taxi, I just briefly instructed my mind. अरे छोटी सी जिंदगी है, इतना टेंशन क्या लेने का. So immediately I could chant, I could focus on my work. But the fourth was very important, deal with kindness. जब रह रहे के याद आता था ना वो incident, I used to say, very good, अच्छा हो गया उसको तुम taxi में नहीं गया, very good, it's okay to be angry. So basically affirming that the mind is okay to be angry and it's okay to want respect. But at the same time, you have not allowed the mind to drag you because you're connecting the mind back to your what? Purpose, your aspiration. So these are the four steps. Awareness in the now. Second, accept without judgment. Third, negotiate with reason. And fourth, deal with kindness. I'll just tell one last example, then you will have hundreds of examples every day. If you start practicing this, it is so simple. I'll tell you one last example. Few years ago, I went with a group of people to Vrindavan, Saraya. Vrindavan is a holy place in North India where ISKCON devotees go every year. Now, I was there leading a group of 100 people. And it was a month of Kartik, which is a very holy month. And the last 3 days are very important. And I gave a class saying that, tomorrow morning, we are all going to be there for Mangalarti Darshan at 3:45. Everybody ready? They all said, yes. And I was the leader of the group. I was like giving them a pep talk. And so tomorrow morning, we all will be there. 4 o'clock when the Darshan opened, we'll all be there. And they all said, yes. So everybody ready for 4 o'clock morning Mangalarti. And at 3:45 in the morning, I'm having a nervous breakdown. I'm scared because I am an introvert. I don't like crowds. I am a loner. But I meet people, of course. And I knew that there will be 5,000 people because it's the last day of the Kartik month. 4 o'clock in the morning, 5,000 people crowding in a temple hall. My mind was... So early morning at 3:45, the mind is shouting, all this is bogus, get lost, get out of Vrindavan, go back to Mumbai, this doesn't work. So I had a choice now to chastise my mind. Come on, you have to do it. Determination. We always talk about determination. And I said, this is too much. I didn't want to go to the temple. And imagine what would have happened. I have told 100 people to come and I'm hiding somewhere. And my mind is feeling this is too much. How will the people I'm encouraging to come to temple be inspired when we deep within, I'm not tuned into this. Are you getting my dilemma? What a predicament I am in. So immediately I followed these steps. Awareness in the now. What's happening? I need what? What does my mind need? My mind needs space. My mind needs space. Mind needs freedom. Mind needs choice. And what am I feeling? I'm feeling scared, nervous, tired. So when I connected to my feelings and needs, mind was, and I accepted, it's okay. You are an introvert, it's perfectly okay. Not everybody likes to be in the crowd. It's perfectly okay. It's okay. It's okay. I accept myself just the way I am. I love myself and I forgive myself. This is an affirmation which I tell myself whenever I go through some emotions which are not acceptable or not, which disturb me. It's okay. It's an emotion, it's a feeling, it's not you. Oh, mind was relieved because I did this instantly, within a minute this happened. So you see what I did? Awareness in the now, what's happening right now? And I accepted. And then the third step, my dear Chanchal, my dear mind, this is Kartik, Vrindavan, last 3 days. What blessings await us, isn't it exciting? You've been talking about it all year and now you are here. Don't you think we should go? By this time the mind had cooperated because the mind had been heard, understood. And then the fourth step is most important. Remember, you know what I did? What is the fourth step? Deal with kindness. You know what I did? I went to the temple. There were 5,000 people, but deliberately, I stood at the western gate, western door, and just at the door, telling the mind, see, anytime you can go out. And then what I did during the Mangal Aarti, which is last half an hour, deliberately, after 5-7 minutes, I went out for half a minute, 1 minute, I strolled around and I came back. Mind go. This is a reassurance to the mind that it's okay. And I stayed in the temple hall for the whole 45 minutes. I was happy that day because I had practiced these three principles of awareness, acceptance, and connecting to my aspiration gently, kindly. So like this, we need to pause, we need to be kind to ourselves and gentle with ourselves and our minds. Trust me, we will be able to live peacefully and happily in this life. One of my realizations is, you know, of the three steps, awareness, acceptance, and aspiration, what do you think is the most important? Awareness? Acceptance? Aspiration? See, we cannot debate on this endlessly. I know the most politically correct answer to say would be all three are important. But in my personal experience, you know, because I write journals every day morning and over a period of time. Now, tomorrow my conclusion could be different. I'm telling today, right now what I'm convinced about. Tomorrow if you ask me, I may give a different answer. But today I'm convinced that of the three, acceptance is most important. I'm telling you honestly, because in my interactions with people, I mean, not just India, everywhere, you know, I'm seeing the biggest problem is 99% of the people I meet, they hate themselves. People actually don't like the way they look. They just don't like themselves. Somehow they have been, I don't want to blame anyone for that, but somehow they have been programmed to dislike themselves. इसीलिए आज आईने के सामने खड़े होकर मैंने खुद से माफी मांग ली, क्योंकि दूसरों को खुश करते करते सबसे ज्यादा दिल मैंने अपना ही दुखाया. तो दिस इज आवर लाइफ. सो देयरफॉर एंड बिकॉज यू नो इन दिस वर्ल्ड वी ऑल गो थ्रू सफरिंग. एनीबडी हियर हु इज नॉट एक्सपीरियंस पेन एंड सफरिंग? वी ऑल गो थ्रू सफरिंग. लेट अस एक्सेप्ट इट. And if some self-help guru or motivational speaker keeps talking about how this world is a great place, and he's lying. People are going through a lot of pain day in, day out. There is suffering. And unless we accept ourselves, we can't face this suffering. Because that suffering will only reinforce our negative self-talk. Kinky is, you know, पॉइजन, जहर. जहर मरने के लिए थोड़ा सा, पर जिंदा रहने के लिए बहुत पीना पड़ता है. राइट? लॉट ऑफ बिटरनेस एवरी डे. यू सी पीपल गोइंग थ्रू सो मच पेन एंड सफरिंग. सो देयरफॉर ऑफ द थ्री, एक्सेप्टेंस इज मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट, बिकॉज आई थिंक वन ऑफ द थिंग्स इट डज इज इट बर्स्ट द बलून ऑफ all the glamour, hype, and all the fluff that we've created about ourselves. When I accept I'm ordinary, I'm small, I'm insignificant, it's liberating. So I have done two things. There are three topics I wanted to cover today. I have covered the first two already. What is the first topic? What is awareness, acceptance, and aspiration? Second topic was how to apply these three principles in our day-to-day life. So I gave a few examples. Is that clear? So now we'll go to the third topic, which is I'm going to share some tips on how we could improve our awareness, acceptance, and aspiration. So again, I'll go back to the book. From the book, for awareness, there are 13 chapters, but I'll just take one right now. And then if we have time, we'll also do for acceptance and aspiration. So this is one of the techniques by which you can immediately see today your awareness improves. This is called technique of observation without judgment. I'll repeat. Now please, those of you who have come in late, please know where we are right now. We have already discussed what is awareness. Awareness means to know what's happening now. Acceptance is to not resist it, take it in. And aspiration is to aim for something higher than the mind. And we've discussed how to apply this also. Now I'm discussing tools by which you can make, because one of the biggest problems is people say awareness is most important, but I'm never aware, right? But there are some healthy habits, some practices if you do every day, you will see over a period of time, your awareness is high. So wouldn't you want that, right? So we are discussing how to improve your awareness. And there are many techniques, like one is chanting. I do meditation for 2 hours, and you don't have to do for 2 hours, but 5 minutes, 10 minutes. And we have experienced Bhakti Yoga teachers here, like I'm part of ISKCON, and we have what is called as Congregation Development Department, CDD. And this Congregation Development Department, I report to about what programs I do. So I have, now we have a team right now of a few teachers of Bhakti Yoga who teach meditation, and through this meditation you learn how to improve your awareness, acceptance and aspiration. So like for example, one of the teachers who conducts every Saturday, every week we have five, six different groups that conduct these programs, and I visit them by turn. Like sometimes I visit 3 groups, sometimes some days I visit only 2, like that. So we have Rasparayan Prabhu and his good boy Gopi Manjari Mataji is one of them. Can you just stand up, bro? He is one of our Bhakti Yoga teachers, a very successful, he has a very successful career in the corporate world, a very good career in US. He left all of that, came to India to serve and teach. We have other teachers also. We have Shyam Sakar Prabhu is also a teacher. Is he here? Can you raise your hand so the people can see you? He is one of the teachers. Rasparayan Prabhu is one of the teachers and of Bhakti Yoga. And we have Murari Nithai Prabhu and his wife, Mansi Radhika Mataji. Murari Nithai Prabhu, can you raise your hand also? Thank you. Where is Mansi Radhika Mataji? She is here? She is outside, okay. Oh, she is there. Can you just stand up, please? So, thank you. So we have like this three, four people. There are more people actually. Vedmurthy Prabhu, can you please stand up? Yes. Madhu Madhav Prabhu is here. Manish Goyal. Manish Goyal. He is one of my colleagues in the monastery. He is in saffron robes. And he is from Delhi. And he is an expert in self-help. He is very good in non-violent communication. In fact, he taught me the principles of compassionate communication. So like this, we have 6 different groups everywhere. Every Saturday, Friday, they meet. And I visit them also. So you can be part of this, and after the seminar, whom do they meet, or is there some system by which they can connect? Outside you will have some desk, right? Yeah. So you can please meet any of us and connect if you want. Okay, right behind here, okay. Okay, fine, there, fine, thank you. So now, I am sharing in this book, not the Bhakti Yoga technique which they will teach you in Bhakti Yoga, but there are also some other basic hygiene practices which you can immediately get benefits. And that is, one is called observe without judgment. Now, I'm going to explain from this book, from this chapter, see if it makes sense. I was once on a flight and I saw a passenger stand up from his seat. His eyes were red and his forehead was wet with perspiration. He looked around, his face twitching, and then with a sudden grin, he hurriedly sat down. A few seconds later, he rose again and paced up and down the aisle, murmuring to himself. The lady who sat next to him was reading a book, but occasionally she would look at him, her lips curled in an expressionless countenance. He is definitely angry with his wife, I thought. This happens with us all the time. He is definitely angry with his wife, I thought to myself. Then I instantly realized I had made a judgment. You know what I read just now in the first paragraph? That was an observation. He got up, he walked, he twirled his lips. All that was an observation. But when I said, when the thought came that he is angry with his wife, that was a judgment. I told myself not to make judgments, but to just observe. Now, why was my judgment problematic? Because, first of all, how could I say that the man was angry? How do I know? And secondly, how do I know that she was his wife? Right? See, the point I'm trying to make is judgments always follow our observations, which is okay. Don't get me wrong. We have to make judgments. But we also have to spend some time in day when we don't make judgments. Is this clear what I'm saying? Like, you know, if you're scientific in your approach, what do scientists do? They make hypotheses, they conduct experiments, they observe, then they draw conclusions, right? But what do? We first judge. Conclusion is first. So when we see people, things, behavior that confirm our belief or theory, then we make strong judgments. Life goes on with more theories, more observation, more judgments. Like someone once told me, Prabhuji, my mind is already made up. Don't confuse me with facts. Mujhe facts mat batao. I'm already. So if I say Rohit Sharma is a great batsman, so is that a judgment or an observation? Huh? Rohit Sharma is a great batsman. Is that an observation or a judgment? Judgment. How many of you feel it's an observation? Wow. Rohit Sharma is a great batsman is an observation. Now, those of you raised your hands just now, to them I have another question. If I say Rohit Sharma scored 3 centuries, including a double century in 3 matches, is this observation or judgment? Judgment? Observation. So now I'll go back to the first question. Rohit Sharma is a great batsman. Is this an observation or a judgment? How many of you feel it's an observation? Eh? Still. It's an observation, is it? I thought it's a judgment, no? How many of you feel it's a judgment? Oh, thank God, majority wins. This is a democracy. See, when I pass a judgment, great is a judgment. But when I say 3 centuries in 3 matches, that is observed. If I say, how is this room? If you say it's hot, it's a judgment. But if I say it's 29 degrees Celsius, it's an observation. Like if you say somebody is characterless, that is a ruling, that is a judgment. But if I say he has sent 4 emails in 1 day disowning his family, I mean, you could point out the fact. You know what, I know what I'm hearing. You didn't say this, but I'm hearing you say that, but I'm expected to judge, I'm expected to decide. How many of you feel you need strong discrimination, strong clarity, right? You should know what is right, what is wrong. You feel like that, right? Now, I'll tell you something. Ironically, it may sound very ironical. To improve judgment, you'll have to give up judgment. I'll clarify. To improve judgment, you'll have to actually give up judgment. When you observe, let's say for 5 minutes, you observe without attaching labels. You release yourself from your confused mind and you enter a higher dimension of reality. This is a platform beyond your bias and prejudice. Often we make mistakes because we observe little and doubt a lot. Now instead, you observe more and analyze less. You will realize that you will come to the real picture faster and better. Observation practices are like sunshine. They remove the fog, the darkness of confusion. Like there is a very famous Persian poet Rumi who said, everyone sees the unseen in proportion to the clarity of their heart. So what is unseen and unknown can be seen. Unfortunately, when it comes to our own life, we are not honest scientists. We carry unshakable opinion of ourselves and others. We think we know who we are. We are also convinced that our prejudices are correct. But the sad truth is somewhere we have lost the connection to our own self and the world. Okay, I'll give an example of how to practice observation. I'll tell you how I do it. This may help you also. And observation practices have improved my awareness. Like today, yesterday morning in the taxi, how could I immediately in the taxi, instead of getting angry with the taxi drivers, how could I become aware of my anger was because I had practiced at other times this observation without judgment. Once when I was going in an Uber, I was very stressed. We had 3 days of management meetings where I had very judgmental, I was having differences of opinion with the monastery members. I was mentally clogged. Hota na? And system hang ho jata. So then I said, okay, now I will stop judgments and for the next 10 minutes, I put my alarm, I took up my mobile phone, 10 minutes alarm. What I will do? I will stop judgments and only observe for next 10 minutes. Now guess what happened? So the taxi started. The taxi was honking, Mumbai traffic. At that time, I saw a couple next to me. Furiously, they were going in their bike, full speed. And they were swerving dangerously on the busy road. And instantly, I judged the young man driving as what? Irresponsible, crazy, style maar raha hai, girlfriend ko impress kar raha hai. All this happened immediately. And then my thoughts raced to one of my relatives who I also lost in a bike accident few years ago. And then my mind immediately went, when I lost that relative, that was in particular year when I had done very well in my academics and I received a scholarship. Then because of that scholarship, I went to Middle East. So then I thought of Middle East. Then I thought of my cousin who had some real estate business in Middle East. You see how my mind is going? And then finally, one of my friends who got envious of him and what he did. And finally, I came back. So, 5 minutes chala gaya. And then, suddenly, I realized, hey, wait, kahan? Where, what happened? Ye kya hua? Kaise hua? Kab hua? So then, when I said, wait, what? You know, 10 minutes ka maine time laga tha. And at around 5 minutes, I realized what is happening. That was victory because that was my moment of clarity. I realized that my mind was wandering everywhere. Mind wandering is not failure. Mind wander kiya, you realized that the mind wandered. Then what happened? What do you think must have happened to me? You know what happened? I scolded myself. You lost 5 precious minutes recklessly imagining scenarios that had no bearing on your present situation. But I had been fooled by the mind again. Mind had entered through the back door. What the mind had done now? You are inadequate. You are a fool. You can't do this exercise. This was another trick of the mind. So this is how the mind tricks us. If you stop the mind, mind will come through the, like, you know, we were in Vrindavan once doing langar, we were standing in the line for prasad, the sadhus. So that man was at the gate, a hefty fellow. So my colleague was next to me. He knows all the big shots in that ashram. So he went in the front and told him, "Mere ko andar jaane do." He said, "Hey, line mein jao, line mein." So he came to me and said, "Just see the fun, wait for 5 minutes. So he went from somewhere, he caught the big boss. Back door se andar gaya, and with that big boss and this my friend, they tapped this man and he looked back and he was shocked to see this guy was there. And then that big boss said, "Abhi kisko bhi bolega jane ko, jane dene ka." So I looked at him, I said, "Wow, this man was stopped here, but he came through the back door." This is how the mind does. If you tell the mind, "No, no, no thinking like this, ye galat hai, ye galat hai, ye galat." And then the mind will come through the back door by scolding you, by coming up with so many thoughts of how you are not adequate, how you are not doing this properly. Either way, the mind is very tricky. So then what I did, is a very messy entanglement. So the simple solution, remember, what are the target? 10 minutes of observe without judgment. So what I did, simple. Come back, my dear mind, observe without judging. So I returned to the scene outside my taxi. I saw a construction site with many workers working. There were shops and temples crowded with men and women dressed in colorful attire. I saw children returning from school. And I saw a cricket match being played on the narrow by lanes. Occasionally, I would judge the events or wander off into past or future. But I gently brought my mind back to the present. And whenever I entered the present, I was in awareness space. Because I could now catch my wandering mind. So, if I go back to that example in the plane, remember plane I was talking? I saw the man angry, disinterested, and his wife sitting next to him. But when I saw myself judging him as angry, I had successfully observed myself. I was now in an observation level. Therefore, it's important. When we practice observation, it's like you are sitting on a helicopter and you have gone above. You know, you are inside your house. You don't know what's happening. But when you're in a helicopter, like you get a complete aerial view. So when we observe, we get a view towards our own life. So, and I've got many other examples on how observation helps. So you can try this for 10 minutes one day and see the difference it makes. So this is an example for observation. So like this, there are 13 chapters, different technique. There is a technique of breathing. Also, I've shared chanting, hearing scriptures. So all that is for improving observation. Now, briefly, there are two more. I'm going to share with you a technique to improve what? Second, acceptance. Now, for acceptance, I have a very powerful technique called self-love. प्यार हुआ इकरार हुआ प्यार से फिर क्यों डरता है दिल ऐसे बहुत सारे गाने हैं इट्स ऑल अबाउट लविंग द अदर पर्सन बट वन ऑफ द बिगेस्ट प्रॉब्लम्स एंड नीड इज सेल्फ लव एंड दिस इज जनरली कंसिडर्ड एज अनहेल्दी एंड अनसेफ इन मेनी सोसाइटीज पीपल थिंक इफ यू लव योर सेल्फ यू बिकम प्राउड पीपल थिंक यू शुड ऑलवेज क्रिटिसाइज योर सेल्फ ऑलवेज So, I have seen that if we want to improve our acceptance, we need to have some degree of self-love. Because when you suffer, you know, nobody can actually understand what you're going through. Because in the deep innermost recesses of your heart, you're alone. So, if you're not at peace with yourself, nobody will be able to help you. So I'll give an example from this book. This is chapter 11 from the acceptance section. You know, once one friend of mine told me, I want honest feedback. After he gave a first class to the community. So I told him the feedback. You know, these are mistakes, you could improve like this. And later on, another friend told me that he was very upset with my feedback. So I said, hey, but he asked for it. And then I understood, actually that was a veil. He didn't want feedback. He just wanted to be loved. So many times we want to be accepted by others. We want to be loved in our social interactions. And when it doesn't happen, we feel let down. So the solution is simple. Seek validation from your own heart. Now, one of the biggest challenges I have faced when I presented self-love is pride cometh before the fall. Have you heard this? It's a very famous statement. We have examples of so many people who have fallen, who have destroyed because of pride. And they are cut off from reality. False pride is very dangerous. And people have told me, oh, self-love, that will lead to over-the-top self-confidence, that will lead to arrogance. And I come from a religious tradition where we cite examples of so many saints who constantly criticize their own existence. So, these prayers reveal deep lamentation. And many preachers, subconsciously, they think this is the way we should also criticize ourselves. Now, when I'm ch- challenge like this, I ask a counter question. Can you criticize yourself without feeling depressed? What is the guarantee that if you keep thinking about your failings, you will not slip to hopelessness, which is simply another side of pride, because that is also ego obsession. I am great is pride. I am bad. I am fallen. Also, I remains the center here also. So therefore, what we need now is self-love, but we can't become proud and arrogant also, right? So I have a technique for you, which I practice every day in the morning for minimum 5 minutes. And this is called a technique of, called, mark these words, fresh gratitude. I didn't say gratitude. I didn't say thankfulness. What did I say? Fresh, just like fruits. People say you should eat fruits. But they say fresh fruits come, right? There is something called as fresh gratitude, which I practice, which I learned in my own journey. Now, all of you agree, gratitude is a very powerful tool. Thanking, like when you thank your family, your parents, your friends. Now, what happens when we thank is we are able to enter a space of humility. We realize that we have been blessed. That is an anti, what do you say, it destroys pride because we are humble and grateful. Now, what happens generally, this becomes boring after some time, because if every day morning you can't thank your parents, family, God, because it becomes a cliche, like you every day you can't do it. So what I do is I make it fresh. I ask myself, in the last 24 hours, what am I really grateful for? That is a game changer. Last 24 hours, what happened? Kya hua? So what happens, then you constantly look for things that you are grateful for. Like it could be something as silly as a lovely breakfast that you had, or a good workout in your gym, or some nice song that you heard. But if you sincerely thank for what you have received, you are entering the gratitude space and you actually feel humble because you have received. There is no scope for pride. And those who give examples of holy saints of the past, who criticize themselves, I tell them that it's true. They criticize themselves. But if you are carrying a heavy baggage of emotional trauma, then it is more practical to thank God than to criticize yourself. Are you getting what I'm saying? So, and these saints who criticize themselves, they don't do it artificially. They are in so much love with God, that so much love that self-criticism came out spontaneously, just like, two lovers in their intimate moments, what they talk and discuss. That's not, you don't record it and you don't write it and you don't prove it to each other. You said this. No, that's very intimate love talk. You may cry, you may criticize yourself, whatever you may do. So when these great saints are criticizing themselves, they are in intimate union with their Lord. So you can't take that and make it as a practice. Okay, I will also criticize myself every day. So like that. A heart that is not feeling rich experience, rich emotions. So please don't criticize yourself. Instead, what you should do? Instead of criticizing yourself? Self-love. So how do we ensure that the self-love doesn't lead to pride? Fresh gratitude. Thanking for the gifts that you've received in the past 24 hours. So this is a way, this is one of the techniques in this book that I've spoken about how to develop. What? Which quality are you talking about right now? Acceptance. Is that okay? And the last I want to discuss is aspiration. We have 10 minutes. Anybody has, should we stop here and take questions? Is that better? I'll complete. Yeah. Okay.
For aspiration also there are many chapters, there are 11 chapters, and I will take just one on scriptures, because I read scriptures every day and I've seen how scriptures purify our aspirations. And Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam. Many times people think, "Arey, to dada pardada ki kahani hai, Ramayana, Mahabharat." No, I've seen that if you are looking for practical solutions all the time, sometimes people come and tell me, "Arey, Prabhuji, your class was so practical today." And sometimes, you know, I was in Sri Lanka this year, last year, and we had taken a yatra, a pilgrimage to the places where Lord Ram and Ravan had fought. So some classes I gave very practical on relationships. So some people came and said, "Very practical class. Thank you, thank you." And next day, I spoke on the Yuddha Khand, the 9 days of battle. So in that class, those who said your class was very practical, they were sleeping. There are other people who are hearing very attentively. And after the class, they came and said, "The class was so nourishing." So I said, "But you already know the Ramayana. You have heard it since childhood." They said, "Nahi, but kuch to andar bahut anand aa raha tha." So I realized that there are two kinds of audiences. One that is looking for practical. And there's another kind of audience which wants to enter that space of wisdom and allow that force which we call as Paramatma or God or energy or whatever you call, that force to reveal the practical solution to you. And that second approach is much better than the practical solution, because the practical solution that you hear from me in my class may not work for you. This awareness, acceptance and aspiration, what I am talking about is my conviction. If you hear scriptures and read scriptures with an open mind, you will be amazed how the Lord will reveal to you your own techniques, your own skills, your own tools. But you don't have the confidence in yourself. You just want ready-made. Aap bas humko khila do, hum khayenge. Humko sochne ko mat bolo. Nahin, but you have to connect to the sound. And that will, if I say, everybody should go for jogging. Jogging is the best exercise. If you are lame, how will it help? But you can take the principle. What is the principle? Exercise, good health. So therefore, practical solutions, those students who look for practical solutions, or they look to be spoon-fed by the life coach, self-help gurus, they will have some problems later on. Because the soul will stay buried in the huge number of self-help skills. See, you have to understand that there is a guru within you. There is a teacher within you, which Vedic scriptures call as Paramatma or the Lord. Now, that guide within, when he reveals to you, when you hear that voice, that is your solution. See, we are all made up of a unique emotional mix. You all agree? What you have gone through since childhood, I have not gone through that. So when I am speaking passionately about something, I may have my baggage. You have yours. But we meet on a plane of scriptures. When I speak Bhagavad Gita, I am allowing you to enter that space. And Ramayana, Mahabharata, I have said some stories here of people whose lives have changed by the way they, and there is a way of hearing also, studying scriptures also. Like, if you are looking for techniques, a lot of TED Talks, a lot of YouTube videos. YouTube can teach you anything. I know somebody who came to me saying that, "Prabhuji, I am addicted to YouTube. Please help me." I couldn't help him. And after 2 months, he came and said, "Prabhuji, YouTube addiction chala gaya." I said, "Acha, kisne bataya?" "YouTube mein mila mujhe video." I said, "Wow." So, YouTube can teach you anything. But still, if you see, people are miserable. There are more YouTube videos than, I think, stars in the sky, you know. But still, why people are miserable? Because these techniques won't help. You need to discover your own solution. It has to be your voice. Actually, there is one story I have not written in this book, but I am feeling tempted now to share, and I am going to share it. I don't care what the world thinks. I didn't put it deliberately because I was scared of some things. You know the real reason why I wrote the book?
Now in the preface, I have written a very superficial story actually, but it's a good story. But that's not the real reason why I wrote the book. The real reason is something else that happened on one night, 2011 August. It was raining heavily. It was Janmashtami. And you know, Janmashtami is our main festival. From 7 in the evening till 12, we were doing kirtan, class. I was exhausted. I came back at 1:32 to my room. I slept. Morning, I got up at 8. And I had a lot of activities the next day. And when I got up, this was a result. Now, I had a hectic schedule. I had just come back from Moscow. I had a lot of traveling, a lot of programs. And when I got up at 8 in the morning, I felt excruciating pain. And the most shocking thing was, it was not in the body. I couldn't point which part of the body was paining. That pain was unbelievable. And then I thought, what is happening? What is this pain? I got out of my room. I came to the courtyard of our temple. And I saw human beings walking around. I felt more pain. I ran back to my room, closed the door. I banged my head on the wall and I fell on the bed, on the pillow. And I realized I had broken down. I was crying, wailing. And then I fell unconscious. I don't know what happened. I slept for a few hours. I woke up after a few hours. I stood on my bed like a statue. This went on for 2 full days and 2 full nights. And then one of my seniors, he came to me and I felt, have I gone crazy? He said, no, you just need a break. You have a high aspiration to serve, but you are disconnected from yourself. You have no awareness and acceptance. I mean, he didn't say these words. I am saying these words. He said, you are disconnected. You need a break. So then he told me, relax. And one of our 64 principles in bhakti that we practice is to sit under a banyan tree. It is given by our Rupa Goswami, one of our acharyas, that one should meditate and worship the banyan tree. So we have a huge banyan tree near our temple. I sat there for every day. I would go spend few hours under that banyan tree and relax, relax. And that's when something amazing happened one day. And I'm being very honest here. You know, banyan tree appears to be ageless compared to you. Like I may have a lifespan of 60, 70, but banyan tree has been there for 300 years. Have you ever experienced peace when you go to a mountain or nature? Why you feel that, you know? Because that mountain or nature is very, very long life, ageless. And do you know something? There is something ageless and eternal within you also. And when you go to that mountain or that banyan tree, that eternal undying self within you meets that eternal mountain, tree, ocean. Ocean side also, you feel very peaceful because that ocean has been there for centuries. And you also have been there for centuries, but you don't know that because of the mind and body cover. So in that banyan tree, suddenly I felt a sense of belonging. I felt a shelter. I felt forgiven. And I heard these three words, awareness, acceptance, and aspiration. And I knew, bang on, that's the answer to my problem. I just need to improve my awareness and acceptance. I already have an aspiration. And then I closely observed life of my past every day after that, and every event I would be able to categorize into any disturbance, any unhappiness, any problems, I would be able to see as a cause of misalignment of one of the three. Now you may say, kaun bola aapko ye awaaz? Now this is the science of sound. Scriptures talk about sound can be at 4 levels. One is sound, like I'm talking. No, before coming for this seminar, some of you must have told your spouse, let us go for the seminar, that is sound. Sound exists in the first level as sound. Let us go for the seminar. Now, before saying this, you may have got a thought in your head. Let us go for the seminar. That is also sound, but not expressed. That is sound in thought. So sound can be gross, which can be heard by the senses, or sound can be in the mind also. Are you getting it so far?
Now, sound can also be in the heart, which is even more subtle. It is an experience, feeling. There must be some experience or feeling which helped you to get this thought that I have to go for this seminar. That is the deeper sense of awareness. That is awareness. So when we practice these principles of mind management, we can connect to that unspoken voice, heart. And that's when you rise above your mind. Otherwise, all that you have spoken, discussed, it's all in the mind only, you know. Ultimately, how can you control your mind when you are analyzing everything through your mind only? You need to connect to something higher than mind to be able to control your mind. Please understand this basic thing. And that higher wisdom is within you. That is, that's called Paramatma. You know, calf. There are 1,000 cows kept, the calf will go to its mother only. What is that force that directs that calf to go to the mother? That force is called Paramatma. That force is within you also. It will help you go to the right action, right activity, your goal of life. Everything will fall in place. Therefore, we need to have this sense of belongingness, sense of smallness, sense of connection with this universe. And if we do that, so I've actually not read the chapter, but I'm talking about scriptures, how scriptures help. When we keep hearing, this helps us connect, this helps us understand. Like I'll tell you, in army, have you gone to, if you go to these military schools, military academies all over the world, they teach some battles. Every military academy teaches some common battles, Napoleon's Battle of Waterloo, or so many battles they teach, Second World War, First World War. Now, I want to ask you something. All these military soldiers who learn all these battles, what do you think they do? When they go for war, like when every war is a unique situation, every battle, in 2611, Mumbai terror attacks, when our commanders entered the Taj to fight the terrorists, do you think they took out their notebook? Are they konsa model use karne ka, konsa theory use? Because they studied for so many years, all the war, nothing will work there. All that hearing is so that their gut, their intuition is sharpened, and on that spot, on that particular day, they trust their inner voice and they act based on the experience, wisdom that they've gathered over the years. This is more practical than I giving you 3 tips or 4 techniques or 5 techniques. So scriptures are that powerful wisdom, because it is coming from a higher realm. When we hear submissively, that sound enters our heart and it awakens the Paramatma. It helps us connect to our own voice. It helps us connect to our own solutions to our problems. Therefore, I request you that please treat this knowledge abundantly. Every Saturday we have our preaching assistants who conduct Bhagavad Gita, Bhakti Yoga classes all over Kandivali area. There are 6 of them. If you want to meet them, know more about them, you can meet me or personally. Also, you can go to the desk there. So we'll stop here. And before I stop, I would like to take 1 or 2 questions, just in case there is some burning question somebody has. Yes, please.
Happy and peace with mind, I will do anything. But jab mera state of mind aisa lagta hai ki मतलब अचानक से लो हो जाता है, I don't know why, बस it's just I know it's low and I don't want to do anything. It's feel like कुछ मत करो, समझ नहीं आता. मम्मी भी बोलती है, जैसे अभी मेरे को मालूम है जैसे प्रोजेक्ट है, प्रोजेक्ट करना है, बट उससे माइंड की कुछ करने का मन नहीं करता. एंड आई एम लाइक मेरे को मालूम है इम्पोर्टेंट है प्रोजेक्ट, बट फिर भी मैं वो कर नहीं पाती हूँ, तो बहुत फ्रस्ट्रेट होता है उसके कारण. और एक बार तो ऐसा होता है मेरे साथ, मतलब मेरा इकोनॉमिक्स का बोर्ड का एग्जाम था एंड अचानक से मेरा माइंड ब्लॉक हो गया. आई लिटरली क्राइड फॉर 2 आवर्स. उसके बाद मेरे को शांत, मतलब थोड़ा पढ़ पाई मैं, थोड़ा अपने माइंड को शांत करके लेट्स डू इट ट्राई, एंड उसके बाद मैं इकोनॉमिक्स कर पाए. सो हाउ टू, मतलब हमेशा, मतलब कैसे अपने माइंड को हैप्पी मोड पे, पीसफुल मोड पे बार बार, मतलब जो मोड पे नहीं जाए.
Thank you for this very, very, very relevant question. So if I understand it correctly, you are saying that कभी कभी इतना low होता है कुछ करने की इच्छा नहीं होती है. And how to not have it and how to be peaceful always? I want to tell you something. Relax. You know, it's perfectly all right to not want to do anything. In fact, do you know something? It requires a lot of hard work to do nothing. Because we are so addicted to be doing, doing, doing. You know what is your body asking when you're going through that? Body is saying, relax. And we have, unfortunately in modern times, relaxation is a bad word. People don't like, if I tell today, tomorrow I have a program. I can't come for this program because I have another commitment and I have these things to do. They'll say, okay. But if I say, no, I cannot come tomorrow because tomorrow is my time with myself. Tomorrow is my me time, relaxation time. Eh? You are so lazy, irresponsible. Right? So our culture doesn't encourage relaxation. So I want to assure you that this is your body and mind saying, relax. And you will see something amazing. When you relax, you will never be bored. Boredom happens because you don't relax. And generally what happens, instead of relaxing, what do? We pick up our smartphone. We start watching all the videos. And we think that is relaxation. That is not relaxation, my dear friend, because we are connecting to electronic world. That's not real world. Okay, simple thing. You see rain on your video and you actually see rain, which will give you more peace. Why? Because it is real. So, you learn to relax. Learn to let go. A dog on the street can entertain you much, much more than the best movie that you see on the screen. I'm not saying don't watch movies. I'm just saying, sabke liye apna apna time hota hai. But I'm just saying that, learn to relax. When you are, see smartphone for example, smartphone constantly checking WhatsApp messages, it gives you a dopamine kick. It doesn't help you relax. Relaxation means do nothing, just observe and see how fresh you feel. So, whenever you feel like that, kuch karne ki ichha nahi hoti hai, that is your mind demanding what? Relaxation. So relax. And it's perfectly fine. Perfectly okay. Is that okay? So if you have a practice of relaxation, like spending time alone, go on a date with yourself. It's important. It's important to spend time alone with yourself. You know, Joseph Louis, I mentioned about him in the book. He's written a book, Last Child in the Woods. He says 21st generation millennials, biggest disease would be nature deficit disorder. They are disconnected from nature because they are constantly doing, doing, doing. But my dear friend, are you human doing or are you a human being? Be. When you are B-E, be, then you can do. If you think I will do, then I will be happy one day, then you will never be happy. You know why? Because you are right now thinking, I will do something and then I will be happy. So till that point of time, you are not happy because you want to do that. And when you reach that, you will not be happy because your mind is trained to think that you will be happy only when you reach some other state. Are you getting it? So better to think, I am happy now only. Kya problem hai? Achha hai. Now that doesn't mean you become shameless and don't study at all. Sometimes, you know, people say, I accept myself just the way I am. I will not improve. Kya improve karne ka problem? Sab achha hai. I say that is not acceptance, that is shamelessness. You know, sometimes in the name of honesty and acceptance, you go to shameless. Honesty means to know where you are, but not remain where you are. That's why we need aspiration also. That's why I'm telling you, all three are needed. But relaxation is very, Abraham Lincoln said, if you give me 7 hours to cut down a tree, I will spend 6 hours sharpening the axe. So, aap thoda relax karo, breathing karo, thoda nature mein ghumo, dost ke saath baat karo. Actually, non-electronic, hum log ekadashi karte hain, in Hare Krishna we do ekadashi, we fast from grains once a 15 days. So I have started a new technique now. I do Ekadashi from smartphone once in a week. So I have a lockup app. I open in the morning, I lock my phone for the next 10 hours. The phone ko bhi shock hota hai. Wo puchta, are you sure? 10 hours? I say yes. And then if you want to unlock it, uska aisa rule hai, bail, you know, it's like taking a person out of bail, you have to pay 170 rupees. I said, I can't pay that much money. I will not pay 170 rupees. So I have got, there are many apps nowadays. So I have seen whenever I'm out of smartphone fasting, there are two chapters in this book on how to handle your smartphone. And there is entire 4 pages on how to deal with WhatsApp. It's called WhatsApp Handle with Care. I've given few stories on how people's lives have changed dramatically after they adjusted their WhatsApp use. And also there is a whole chapter on smartphones and this free Wi-Fi. How this free thing came up. Pura uske upar research material hai. And it's not a technical language, it's very simple stories I've mentioned. So I request you to read that. Is that okay? We'll end with this. Any one last another question? Okay, madam, here, and then we'll end with this. Thank you. Once again, before you ask the question, I want to express my sincere gratitude to all of you for giving an opportunity to share about my book. I feel very, very grateful that I felt very shy initially, but then I said, shyness gaya, side mein rakho usko. Share your heart, you know, I wanted to be authentic and I'm grateful you gave me a chance. Yes, last question.
Sometimes aisa hota hai ki kisi kisi ka expectation pura karne ke liye, boss ka ho, relation mein ho, to hume man maar ke wo karna padta hai. Maybe we are unhappy in that situation, we may have guilt afterwards and wo man khata rehta hai. To, but very painful and I want a solution.
Beautiful, beautiful. So this is a real life problem you are saying about how many times we have to do things out of obligation, right? So I have a rule in life. There is something called have to do and there is something called want to do. Aap kabhi kya karo? Main aapko ek question puchta hoon. Kabhi aap ek diary aur ek notebook aur pen lo. Imagine God comes in front of you and says, you have no obligation. Kuch nahi karna hai aapko. आपको जो आपको अच्छा लगता है वही करो. नो टू डू, नो हैव लैंग्वेज. यू नो व्हेन यू गेट अप इन द मॉर्निंग, आई हैव टू डू दिस, इट इज सो डिसएम्पावरिंग. हैव टू डू, यू एंटर द गैप मेंटेलिटी. इफ यू वांट टू लिव इन अ गेन मेंटेलिटी, यू हैव टू आस्क व्हाट आई वांट टू डू टुडे. तो इसलिए क्या करो, आप पहले ऐसे कुछ चीजों के लिखो विच यू वॉन्ट टू डू. Let's say 25 things are there. That is your basket of happiness. Now, we have to do, because we have responsibilities. We have made a choice. And for every choice, nothing comes free in this world. So convert everything that you have to do to some want that you are getting fulfilled through that. Like, you know, one lady told me, I have to go to the school every day morning, correct all the papers because I have to do it. I said, no, you don't have to do it. No, I have to do it. I have no choice. I said, no, you have a choice. Don't do it. No, if I don't do it, then I will get money. So you want the money? Yes. So don't say, I have to go to school. Say, I want to go to school because I want the money. Language change karo aapka. I have to say, I want to karo. Kuch kuch is nahi ho sakta hai. Know that those things are the price you have to pay for everything, you know. If everything happens the way you want, then you will be God. हम लोग गॉड नहीं है. सी, और आई नो बेस्ट रियलाइजेशन कम्स इन लाइफ व्हेन वी सैक्रिफाइस फॉर समबडी वी लव एंड वी डू थिंग्स व्हिच वी डोंट लाइक नेसेसरली, बट उसमें रिलेशनशिप ग्रो होता है. बट इफ यू आर ओनली डूइंग दैट, देन यू विल गेट डिप्रेस्ड. तो बैलेंस करने का, तो जो अच्छा लगता है, जैसे आई लव टू डू, आई लव टू गो इन नेचर, आई लव टू राइट जर्नल. सो मॉर्निंग टाइम एवरी डे आई गेट अप लिटिल अर्लियर देन एवरीबडी एल्स एंड 1 आवर आई राइट जर्नल. I write love letters to myself. So you can do that. You can. So for me, it is journal writing. For you, it could be gardening. I don't know. I'm just giving example. For you, it could be gardening. For somebody, it could be going to an NGO and teaching small children. अरे जो अच्छा लगता है वो करो आप. फिर उसमें आपको strength मिलेगा वो करने के लिए जो आपके responsibilities और duties हैं. So इस तरह से we have to balance. Is that okay? थोड़ा अपने लिए भी जिया करो. And that's why I said self-love is very important. Most people are suffering because of guilt. They do because they feel guilty. You have to do, if you do things out of love, you can do it longer. I know one lady who is serving her mother-in-law day in day. She is bedridden. She is just not able to handle it. She's in so much stress. She's going crazy. And then her husband said, okay, relax, you know, you can't do it all. But then she's feeling guilty now that in that condition, she's not able to care for the mother-in-law. So I told this family, I said, wait, wait. You need to put her in an old age home now. Be practical. I said, care has to be in the area of, first you have to see her comfort. And within that comfort, you take care of her. Otherwise, you are going crazy. You can't do it. You are forcing yourself out of guilt. And that guilt will kill you. Self-care is not selfishness. Selfishness is when you don't think about others at all. Selflessness, people in the name of selflessness, they become martyrs. Shaheed ho jate hain. Aur unki shaheed gata koi gata nahi. And in the name of, and other people go to other extreme. In the name of caring for oneself, they become selfish. Ideal is care for the self. Know what you want to do. And within that comfort circle, give to the society. Give. Giving mein anand hai. But to give, you have to receive. You receive from doing what you love to do. You get strength from that. Then you give. Is that okay? Thank you very much for your kind attention. My sincere gratitude to all of you. Hare Krishna.
Like everyone in the room, Prabhuji, I'm too grateful to you for sharing with us such effective tools to mind your mind. And I'm certain with this knowledge, we will increase our emotional quotient and establish a meaningful relationship with ourselves and with our loved ones. Thank you. Pleasure. I also want to thank my audience for your keen interest and undivided attention with which you've sat throughout the session. To relish this knowledge daily and conveniently, you can follow Prabhuji on the details that you will share on the slide now through different social media interfaces, and also subscribe to the YouTube channel where you'll get to the similar knowledge. As Prabhuji mentioned, that we do a lot of programs in Borivali and Kandivali. So we urge you to approach our information desk and get information on our program details. So hence, please share your phone numbers and your name so that we'll notify you with our programs. Well, today in seminar, we've just touched the tip of the iceberg. To experience the entire iceberg, we've arranged a book kiosk for all of you. And good news, we have a book at a discounted price. Discounted, not even an Amazon price, our special price for all your loved ones here. So please grab a copy now. And at the same time, you can even get the book signed by the author at the book signing table till about 9 p.m. this evening. Well, this celebration is incomplete without a delicious meal. So be our guest and enjoy the dinner being served there. Thank you once again. Hope to see you again with the same joy and enthusiasm. Beautiful evening ahead. Thank you. Thank you.